My name is Jeroen van Loon. I'm an artist from Utrecht, and I'm working on trying to create art that shows digital culture. Come to the front. This talk will consist out of a few parts. I'll give an introduction of myself, my work. I will show a few of my core artworks that I've been making the last couple of years. Then I will be talking about my handwriting project, in which I used handwriting in order to document and to visualize digital culture. And then I'm hoping for your participation in this project. Early on, I was fascinated by computers. This was the first moment that I got a Super Nintendo from Santa Claus, I believed. From that point on, I always continued playing video games on the Super Nintendo, on the PC, on the PlayStation, and so on and so on. Eventually, I went to school. I went to art school. Before art school, I studied IT media production, where you learn how to code, how to program, how to make websites and use Photoshop, use Flash, and so on. After that, I went to art school, not knowing exactly what I wanted to do with art. And in the final year, I realized that I wanted to create art about the influence of the internet, and not per se new gadgets, new technologies, or something else, but mainly how all this digital technology, this digital media, changes our culture, changes our lives. And I've been doing that since 2010. The first work that I want to show is Kill Your Darlings. I created it in 2012. It's an installation that uses Twitter messages and Twitter photographs. So I suggest we just first watch the video, and I'll talk a little bit about it. So what you just saw were Twitter messages. First you see the photograph, it's the profile picture of the actual girl who writes the actual Twitter messages. And I stumbled upon this when I was using Twitter myself. I always thought I'd use Twitter in a very professional kind of way. I tweet about my artwork, about my art practice. I follow other artists and other studios and so on and so on. But of course you end up in a filter bubble, and trying to break out, I just started to follow other people that I didn't know, and follow their other people, and their other people, and their other people, and eventually I ended up with teenagers, and I saw how they used the Twitter medium, and they use it on a completely different level than I did, not professionally, but just very open, almost like a chat box, like the way you used a chat box in the earlier days. And I wondered if they actually knew that I could be watching, or other people could be watching, that is all this information is out there in the open. So I started to look for the very harsh bullying tweets, and eventually I scraped Twitter of the Dutch and the English bullying tweets, and combined them with the people who wrote them, and created the artwork about it, which is, you can see it here, the entire heart. I think it's about 2,000 Twitter messages and 2,000 Twitter profile pictures, and all the content is authentic. So the girls actually published the Twitter messages, and the artwork is also used in schools to teach children about how they should use social media, how they could use social media. A very different project is sellout.me. More personal. This is me when I'm in Erasmus hospital, where I got a blood sample taken, and from the blood they created my DNA analysis, and I sequenced my DNA, so I have my complete DNA structure sequenced. All this data of mine is stored on a hard drive. The hard drive is placed into this artwork inside the server cabinet. So you see the server, the DNA data running, and on the top screen you see this website, which says selling an artist's genome, 380 gigabytes of personal DNA data. The artwork lasts 1 year, so for 1 year people could place an offer on my DNA data. And the goal was to look for ways to be able to speak about DNA data as if it was financial data, as if it was data that can be sold. Nelly Kroes was actually my inspiration. She wrote in a speech, data is a new gold. So I figured if data is a new gold, then also my big data, my own big data and your big data can be gold. So what would be the price tag of my DNA data? And it was kind of an interesting process. A few things were interesting. One, I got a little bit scared towards the end of the project for who would be the new owner, who would be the new owner of my DNA data, and what could this new owner do with my actual DNA data. And the other point was, what if somebody would buy it for €1 instead of a different price? So I thought I have to create a contract where people, if somebody wants to buy it, then they have to sign a contract which states what they can and cannot do with my DNA data. And I would start the bidding price at the production cost of the artwork. That was my solution. But a few weeks after I thought of these solutions, I thought it's pretty a lame way to break down the whole concept of selling my own DNA data with a contract which I decide what somebody can do and cannot do with my DNA data, and to start at the production price. So eventually there was no contract, and the starting price was €0. So eventually, and perhaps maybe the price of DNA data is actually lower than the production price, but who knows. In 1 year I will have the answer. A different problem on selling DNA data is that, of course, it's not only my data. When you sell credit card information or other types of digital information, then it's mostly just your data. But when you sell DNA data, it's not only my DNA, it's not only my information, it's also the information of my sister, my son, my parents, my grandmother. Some of their stuff is in my DNA data. So if I sell it, I'm more or less responsible for them also. And these sorts of questions started popping up, and I decided to ask 4 companies to help me with answering these questions. So I asked Christie's, is of course the art company. I asked Erasmus Medical Center from an ethical point of view, KPMG from a financial point of view, and Fox IT from a cybersecurity point of view. And I asked them to write me a letter from which they would explain the artwork. So I wanted to know from them, how do you think about selling human DNA data? And these letters are quite important. They're also a part of the art project. And I want to show you a few of the quotes. The first one is from Elina Bunnik, who works at the Erasmus MC as a bioethical professor. She writes, how does one express the moral value of DNA? Can it be converted to a monetary unit? Could we possibly conceive of something like a moral selling price in relation to the actual cost price? This is the main question of this artwork. For what price could you sell human DNA data? Sander Klaus and Nat Wielaert from KPMG wrote, Jeroen's DNA profile has no monetary value at this moment. It will only be valuable if Jeroen finds a way to get another 100,000 people, or preferably even more, to offer their DNA profiles for sale. So they argue one single human DNA profile is worthless because you have nothing to reference it to. You only know what kind of information is inside, what kind of information is valuable of my DNA profile if you can compare it to other people's profiles. Pim Volkers from Fox IT writes, if this value is not clear at when we sell or hand over our DNA, we could end up like the farmer who sells his ground for a small profit and is then forced to watch as the gold is mined from those grounds. So the things we know about DNA data today may be different than what we know about DNA data in 5 or 10 years. So perhaps DNA data will be worthless in 5 years, or perhaps it will be even more valuable because we do more research, we write more papers, we know more stuff about DNA data in the future. So it's very difficult to say what we know today of DNA data and how to put a price tag on it. The last perspective is from Peter van der Graaf, who works at Christie's Amsterdam, and he writes, what is the value of Jeroen van Loon's DNA? As I've said before, past results are no guarantee for the future, but if financial value can be attributed to Manzoni's excrements, at what price will Jeroen van Loon in his entirely sell? And Piero Manzoni was an Italian artist who canned his own feces with the idea everything as I make as an artist is valuable, so also my own shit. And he was actually right, because these scanned feces he created, they sold, I think, over per piece for $200,000 per piece of his feces after his death, of course. But so it's an interesting perspective. And the following thing you're going to see is the last, I think, 30 seconds of a year-long online auction of my DNA data. So these are the final 30 seconds when I actually am negotiating with the people who placed the offers. There were 4 different parties who placed the offer. And eventually somebody has the highest offer, of course.
Is 12
here? Yeah. Almost at the same time that it became 12 o'clock, so that the whole year-long process was finished, the battery died of the camera and it stopped recording. So it was kind of symbolic that everything was really finished. And the artwork is bought by the Verbeke Foundation from Belgium. It's a private art collector. So my DNA data has been sold for €1,100. And he has now the full control of this data, of this artwork. He decides what he wants to do with it, if he wants to show it, if he wants to destroy it, if he wants to take a look inside of the DNA data, what it actually says about me, or about my sister, or about my son. So if you want to see my DNA being owned by somebody else, you can go to the Verbeke Foundation in Belgium, and you can see the server cabinet and the actual DNA. And the person in front of the server cabinet is my father, who went there to look at my/his DNA data. The last project I want to show before I start talking about documenting digital culture through handwritten letters is On Internet, which was created in 2015. I became interested in temporary data that is not created to be stored, but it's created to be lost forever after it's been viewed, like sort of a Snapchat data. And I decided to create, you know, like a glass internet, an internet of glass where through the use of a smoke machine, smoke stick signals are blown inside of the glass internet, and eventually the internet fills up with smoke data, binary smoke data, and after you start watching it, it eventually becomes empty without data. And I have a short clip which shows you the manufacturing process of the artwork and also the artwork itself. So the structure of the work, if you haven't figured it out yet, the structure of the work are the actual undersea internet cables that connecting our continents, only in a minimalized form. So this is my most ideal version of our internet, an internet where data is not created to be saved for later, but data that is created to be experienced right now in a moment, and after we experience the data, it's gone forever. It's a nice little bridge to the first handwriting project, which is actually not about deleting data or letting data evaporate into thin air, but primarily about documenting DNA or documenting data. It was in 2010 when I started to use handwriting in my artwork. I started to go offline in 2010 for 2 or 3 months, and in these 2 months I decided also to create an analog blog, so not a digital blog but an analog blog where I each week I would write about how my life had changed as a digital native without an internet connection and without a computer to use. So each week I would write a blog post on a typewriter. I would copy it on a stencil machine, and I would place the stenciled sheets into an envelope, and I would send all the envelopes to my blog readers that that had subscribed through the traditional post system to the blog. So everybody who was subscribed to the blog would receive a small booklet with some envelopes inside and with some letters. And each week they would receive a new letter to put inside of their booklet. And it was kind of funny because I analyzed that I spent 220 some hours each month behind a computer before I started this project, before I went offline. Then I went for offline for 2 months. I spent 0 hours behind a computer. And there were two things that I still remember today, because it's been quite a while since I done it. The first thing was that I didn't miss the use of social media for a single second, which I found quite interesting and quite strange, actually, because before the project started, I spent a lot of time on Facebook, as a lot of people do. Placing new status updates, following people, checking what people are saying, what people are doing, and so on and so on and so on. But when the project started and I had to quit internet and the computer, I didn't miss the whole social media bubble for one single second. And I didn't really know what that was saying about me. Was it that social media wasn't important? That I can just quit it and it doesn't really matter? And the other thing was that without a computer and without an internet connection, I regained control over the information flows inside of my life. So when I had a computer and when I had an internet connection, all these different information ports or channels were open to me. I have a web browser, and I have email, and I have social media, and I'm watching YouTube, and I'm working with Photoshop, and so on and so on. Everything is simultaneously entering my life, and I have to figure out what is the most important to be able to work, to actually work. And when the computer internet wasn't there anymore, I literally went from multitasking to single tasking. I just chose one task, I did the task, and when the task was finished, I chose a different task and I finished that task, and then I started choosing another task. So it was very calming feeling that I was in full control of all the information that entered my life. Of course, some things became more difficult. For example, to find a telephone number, which took me 2 days without the use of a computer and in an internet connection. And another thing happened, which was actually that I started asking my blog readers also to write me comments back to me in a handwritten letter. So I asked them, how would your life change if you didn't have an internet connection? And this was actually the gold mine of that project, that I received handwritten letters from Dutch people, from all ages, all occupation, all sorts of different backgrounds. And they all wrote me very personal letters on how their life would change without an internet connection. And this is actually the seed of the next project, which is called Life Needs Internet. Because this is very interesting, and the letters were very, very interesting and very beautiful handwritten. But they were all written by Dutch people. And in the Netherlands, more or less, everybody has an internet connection. And if you don't have it at home, you go to the library or to work and you access internet there. So I started to wonder, what would people write if they didn't have an internet connection or didn't have a computer at home? And this was the birth of the project Life is Internet, which I'm still working on today. I decided to started travel, and I wanted to travel to places that were the extreme opposite of my Western access to digital technology, and ask people there to write me again a handwritten letter in their own native language on how they feel about the influence of the internet today. Again, I have a small clip to introduce the project.
Yeah. Ano kayo? Ano kayo?
Siapa nama?
Isai.
Yeah. Kamu tinggal di mana?
Di Oboma.
Oboma. Yeah. Desa di mana Oboma?
Kelurahan.
Di Papua. Di Papua. Ada komputer di sini di desa?
Tidak ada.
Tahu apa ini? Apa itu komputer?
Tahu, tapi tidak ada.
Tidak ada. Internet apa itu?
Tidak tahu
apa itu internet. Kamu pikir kalau coba untuk apa itu internet? Coba. Internet.
Budaya. Iya, budaya.
Terima kasih.
So that was the most perfect answer I could get. And it, in these 7 months I traveled looking for places that were the extreme opposite of my access to internet. West Papua was always my kind of my holy grail. I decided I wanted to go there. I thought this is the best place to find places where people don't know the concept even of internet. I met a lot of people in different places who maybe didn't have an internet connection or didn't have a computer at home, but they always knew what the internet was, more or less. And in Papua, I met a few people who didn't know what the concept of internet was, for example, Isaac. And I had all these very great, interesting questions. I thought I wanted to ask him if I met somebody who didn't know what the internet was. And then I met him, and he said, I don't know what it is. And then, yeah, I really didn't know what to ask him next because he didn't know what the internet was. So how could I come up with a follow-up question? But his answer on what he thinks in the internet is culture is, of course, the most perfect answer because, of course, internet is culture. Internet creates culture. For the youngest generation now, what we call digital culture is their traditional culture. And that's the whole point of the project of Life Needs Internet, to document how we feel and think about the internet. Not in any technical terminology and how fast the internet is and which country has more internet connection than another country, but just how we feel and think about the internet. And the first thing I did was I created a video installation in which I showed eight different persons from different countries and their letters, and I ordered them from zero access to the internet to more or less 100% access to the internet. And the funny thing is, when you read all the letters, the first four more or less letters, in the first four letters people write on a very functional basis of the internet, of about the internet. So they miss the internet because they want to chat, or they want to use Excel, or they want to use other programs, or they want to know what is happening in a different country or a different island in their country. It's a very functional, there are very functional letters. But the more you get to 100% access to the internet, people started writing more pessimistic about the internet, a lot more emotionally, that they cannot fulfill their life without an internet connection, that they feel lost without an internet connection. And so it's very interesting to think about the amount of internet access you have in your life and the way you feel about the internet. So the video installation is one part. I also created lifeinternet.com, a website of a database, a visual database, in which I archive all these letters that I receive from people. And it's a searchable website, so we can search on gender, category, age, or country. All the letters are translated into English. You always can see the original letter and the eventual translation. And I want to show you a few of these examples because these are really the heart of the project. Let's just start. Jinra from Lebanon writes, I received the iPhone as a gift for my birthday. It's definitely a double-edged sword. Sometimes I wish I hadn't received it. She is around, I think, at the time of writing, 26, 27. I think this is a really prime example of that generation that hasn't really figured out. Perhaps the first generation that grew up with the internet that hasn't really figured out what is the actual place of the internet in their life. What do you want to do with all these possibilities, all these information channels? Do you need to stay updated on everything, or do you need to build in a sort of filter in your life? For me, this is a really I feel the same way. When I first got my iPhone, I installed all the apps that were available, and I spent the whole day getting new notifications and reading all sorts of stuff that didn't really matter. But if I look at my iPhone now, that there's almost no app on it that gives me any notifications. I completely shut all the things down that were 24/7 information channel into my life. And I think a lot of people feel this way because they feel that they're missing control about the digital life. Another beautiful letter is from Jingwen from China, who writes, "Without internet, it becomes difficult to share feelings, maybe by telephone, but it doesn't include strangers from the net." So for her, from her perspective, sharing feelings is important. Of course, we all share feelings with our parents, with our sisters and friends and so on and so on, and partners. But for her, what is very important that she has to share feelings with strangers, and that is very difficult by telephone. And she is 23 and a half at the time of writing, she writes. And this is a really, really good example, I think, of the sharing culture, the social media culture that people grew up in, and that sharing your life stories, your thoughts and your experiences to strangers is a normal thing for them. William from the Netherlands, who is 11 at time of writing, he writes, "After school, I'm a full-time web developer and web designer. And I met him for a different project, and he's like the people who walk around here. Feels himself completely free on the internet because he can do anything he wants on the internet. He can learn anything he wants on the internet. He doesn't have to wait for school or for somebody else. He can make his website, build his website for his clients, which are actually the clients of his father, because he is not allowed to get paid for his work, of course. But this is somebody who has been born at the right time, at the right place, he can really fulfill his true potential on the internet. And I think he will do eventually." This is Lily from India. I met her during my travels, and she wrote, "Someone who doesn't use the computer in life is missing out in life," which is kind of a bold statement. And it's funny because she doesn't own a computer. She doesn't have a computer at home. She has to go to an internet cafe to use a computer. But still, having a computer in your life, she feels, is so important that without one, you cannot fulfill the true potential in your life. Roos from the Netherlands writes, "Digital information has made modern men suffer from digital incontinence." She writes a very beautiful, very critical letter on our digital culture, saying that all the data that's available online, all the websites, all the photos, all the links, all the endless possibilities with all this data and all these websites and all these services, it makes us suffer from digital incontinence. We are unable to choose what is beautiful anymore, what is the best thing. We make 1,001 pictures of the same bird we see in the forest, and we save all the pictures because it doesn't cost us any money, and there's never a time where we have to choose which of that 1,000 pictures is actually the best one. This is also a really, really good one, really positive one, from Denise from the Netherlands, who writes, "When we are together, I sometimes miss Skype. Then I go to another room and I start Skype just to hear how he's doing." And you need to know the backstory. She writes about having a long distance relationship, and a really long distance, as he lives in I think in Amsterdam, and her partner in America, I believe. In the beginning, there was no Skype, so they had to call each other, which was kind of expensive. So you had short, intense phone conversations. Then came Skype, and everything became very, very cheap, if not free. And she writes, "Yeah, Skype was the most perfect way to communicate, because you can just turn your Skype on, do the dishes, and sometimes talk to each other if you want to. Eventually they started living together in Amsterdam, and now she writes, she misses the feeling that Skype gave her. She misses the feeling that the Skype jingle gave her, because when she got called through Skype by her partner, it was more or less of really a quality moment. So she dropped everything she was doing and she started to have a Skype conversation with her. So now when they're both living inside of the same apartment, sometimes they go to each to a different room and start Skype and talk to each other through Skype, even though they're in the same apartment. So I think this is a very beautiful example where digital technology is not the wall between people. I think that's something we really love to see, that the internet is a wall between people, but this is a very good example where it actually brings people closer. Ong Peng from China writes, even when on a holiday, the first thing I check is the availability of internet access at the hotel. He also writes a story about a world where his work continues 24/7, even in the weekend. There's no off time anymore. All the work continues, even though it's past his work time. And I believe now in last year in France, they accepted a law which says that for me as an employee, I don't have to answer if my boss emails me in the weekend. It's okay if I not answer my boss. And they have a special law for that, making people, because people ask for it, and makes them more relaxed. The last one I want to show you is from Tim from the Netherlands, who is, I think he was 4 or 5 when he wrote this, or drew this actually. And he just makes a picture. Son, computer, boy, girl, house, iPad. And this is of course the youngest generation, and I have a son of 3 now. So I have to make these decisions about what kind of role will the internet play in his life, and what kind of view of the internet will he have. He doesn't have the view we might have, that we first had to have a modem, a fax machine, and then a desktop computer, and then a smartphone, and so on and so on and so on. The internet is just there, like water from the tap. And now comes actually the most important part of my talk, because I'm of course very interested in how you feel and think about the internet. And if you want to be part of the Leibniz Internet Project, I have forms here, anonymous forms, and I really would love that you would just write me a letter on how you feel about the internet today. Almost like a diary. Everything is good, there's no bad or good letter. Just write your thoughts on how you feel about... The main question is, how does the internet affect your daily life? And how does this make you feel? It's anonymous. You can leave your email if you want to, so I can get in contact with you if I want to publish this information in an art book or something. But it all stays anonymous, and I scan the letters, I put it on the website, I translate it. You can write it in your own native language. So the whole translation process, that's my problem. So I'm just going to pass them out. I have pencils. So please write me your thoughts on how you feel about the internet.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening, and I hope you enjoyed my talk. And if there are any more questions about this project or another project, then I would love to answer them. Yeah. Sorry? Yeah?
Yeah? Okay. Thank you for the presentation. Have you thought, while doing this project, about geopolitical settings of those internet cables running off the on the seabed of the oceans? Because that's actually a very problematic issue. Like, how those cables are distributed, who has access to internet and who isn't.
Yeah.
And while for us, as Westerners from the global north, so to say, it's quite exciting to meet somebody in West Papua New Guinea who doesn't have access, but at the same time, it's a highly problematic issue. And there are activists also in that very place that use internet as activists to expose to what Indonesia, for example, does to them. But this is just one example. But my question is, have you thought about these geopolitical settings?
Well, I ask people to write me a letter in which they write about how they feel about the internet. So if somebody from West Papua would want to write that kind of story, then that's okay. So the whole Lions Internet project is a documentation project. And so it's I don't have a function in deciding what people can and should not or should write in their letters.
Yeah, I understand, but this was more about who has access and who doesn't, like who is in power. And
yeah, now well, the problematic thing, of course, is for this artwork that it's more difficult to reach people and that don't have internet connection and ask them what they feel about the internet, or do they miss it or not. It is possible because I received a batch of letters from Cuba in which people write similar stories, because it's very regulated in Cuba. It's my job as an artist to find the people and to find these stories. But that's my answer. I it's a documentation project, so I'm doing this now, I think, since 2012, and I started going back to some of the areas. And it's interesting to see how people, for example, in 2012 wrote about the internet in some area, and how they write about the internet today. So in my mind, when I continue this project for the next 5 or 10 years, I have this huge collection of letters from people, which we can use, or maybe other social scientists can use, on how we feel about the internet, how digital culture has changed. And of course, there are areas which do not have this 24/7 global online world that we experience here in the West. Yeah, but I hope to show that actually through these letters that people write that. Yeah. Okay, if there are not any more questions, then thank you.
Thank you.